Hello. In this video, we'll explore Google's new Text Embedding API in their Vertex AI suite. This is specifically a new generative AI capability that allows us to power various natural language text and machine learning workflows with really good text embeddings. We're going to do this in a completely step-by-step way with a real-world use case. Specifically, we're going to use Vertex AI pipelines to create embeddings and also generate nearest neighbors and distances for new text content to identify similarities. At the point of this video's recording, the Text Embedding API is only about a week old. As a part of this full end-to-end workflow, we're going to use some Terraform assets to provision our matching engine index, as well as some networking resources that we need for this entire system. We will provide all the code for this system in the description of this video. So let's jump right in and get started. The first thing that we need to do is enable some required APIs, and then we'll look at the Vertex AI provisioning with Terraform. First, go to Vertex AI and enable all the recommended APIs here. While that's enabling, let's also enable the Compute Engine API, as many of the managed services use some capabilities that are part of this foundational service. For completely new projects, consider enabling the Service Networking API as well. These should be relatively quick to enable, so let me go ahead and go back to the homepage for Vertex AI, and let's get started on the code while these embeddings are being enabled. All right, I'm going to use Google Cloud IDE just for simplicity here, so we don't have to do any local setup and can also take advantage of some pre-installed and pre-configured CLIs for this setup. You could certainly use whatever approach you prefer. Before we run these Terraform provisioning commands, we can even see the model that we're going to be using in the new Vertex AI model garden. The embeddings for text here is what we'll be using. Again, these text embeddings can power a pretty wide variety of use cases. This essentially translates some natural language text into an array of floating point numbers that can be used more easily by machines and especially machine learning algorithms. We'll be using the Python SDK to run and use this text embedding API, and again, we'll be doing that in a pretty production-grade way by using Kubeflow pipelines on Vertex AI. All right, let's create a folder here for our Git repository, and let's start to create some files. I'm just going to make a repository for the Terraform files, since we'll also have some Python in this workflow. Since we don't have much, we can just go ahead and use a single main.tf file for our Terraform provisioning here. So bringing in some Terraform code, let's look at all the pieces here. We're going to set up a VPC specifically for this matching engine inference, and we're going to pair that with Google Cloud Service Networking. We'll export and import custom routes from that peering connection and then set up our index here. Now, importantly, the index is going to be based on some data that we provide in Google Cloud Storage, and we haven't created that yet, so we're going to need to set up a bucket with some data to be able to provision this last resource. Let's go ahead and perform an initialization and also apply some of these resources, expecting that we'll get an error for the index since the bucket doesn't yet exist. So there's our expected error. We don't yet have the bucket, but if I run Terraform apply again, note that we got 2 out of those 5 resources provisioned, and the rest is going to wait on that bucket. That's okay. Let's go ahead and create that bucket now, and also we're going to need the data in that bucket. Let's go ahead and, just in the GUI, create this bucket and walk through some of the concepts. We're in the bucket interface here, and I'll create it with the name Text Similarity Test. Just note that, in your case, this name may be taken, and these names need to be globally unique. Now, the only thing we need to change here from the default is the location type. For Google's matching engine for vector similarity, you need the data and the index to be co-located, so we'll use the US Central in both cases. Then we'll create it. Public access prevention is fine, and we've got our bucket. Now let's create some data here. As we alluded to earlier, we're going to use some real-world data about blog posts from our software solution studio. Here we have a blog with lots of blog posts around cloud engineering, simulation engineering, and data engineering. We're going to determine what the closest blog posts are for each post so that at the end of the page, we can provide recommendations in our related posts section. These files are actually going to be markdown files based on the framework that we use for the website. So if I go to the data and content, for example, here's an example post in rendered markdown and raw markdown. We're going to be feeding this text to the Vertex AI matching engine to determine what other blog posts are similar to the one in question. Let's go ahead and bring that data directly into our bucket. We will create a folder, let's say for blog posts, in case we want to do text similarity on other text content, and then we'll differentiate from the matching engine files by having the raw data in a content folder. From here, I'm going to drag in all those blog post markdown files directly. With them all being pretty small text files, that upload is now complete. So we've got our data. Now, before we create our matching engine index, we do also need to create a data file for that content. This is a line delimited JSON file that has all the embeddings for those files. We'll definitely want to generate those in a batch way, and we're going to do that with a serverless Vertex AI pipeline. Let's say this is for generating embeddings, and we're going to just use a Kubeflow pipeline file for that. So if we bring in some content to run that pipeline, we can walk through it here. But really, this is a pretty simple pipeline. We just have a single Kubeflow component, and it's using the Google Cloud AI platform Vertex AI library to use that text embedding model that we've talked about earlier. We're going to open each blog post, which are those markdown files in our Google Cloud storage bucket, and we're going to get the embeddings for them. Now, this piece here is a structure that we need to have in our data file for the matching engine. We need to provide an ID, which is a unique string, the embedding values, and then optionally, we can have this restricts key, which is for filtering and providing some logical boundaries between our vectors so that we can use more advanced queries and filtering in our interfaces. We're just going to be saving that data file and then we'll be good to go. We'll probably need to install some libraries here, such as KFP. We've decided to use the KFP version 2 for this pipeline, so need to specify that pre flag in the pip installation. Let's retry that installation. And we're looking good. All right, now running again, we get our pipeline demo file. And let's put this in our cloud storage bucket. Instead of uploading it straight from our laptop, let's put it in this blog post directory. It looks like I have a misspelling of our bucket here, so let's try that again. There we go. Now, note that we are hard coding the bucket name in here. You can mess around with the parameterizations. For example, maybe you want to provide this on each pipeline run, in which case you use a string argument here, or you could pull this out and have it be a constant defined upfront. Feel free to play around with this code a little bit, which again is in the description of this video. But that's enough to take a stab at this here. So let's refresh to make sure that came in, and there's our pipeline file. Let's go out to Vertex now and run this pipeline, which will give us the data that we need to create our matching engine index. Select our file. Most of these things will be auto-populated. Let's continue and then use the same bucket for our output directory. And that should be good. Submit. It looks like we've got a failure here, so let's inspect that in the logs. It's not liking the output directory for our embeddings, so we'll go ahead and fix that, no problem. It's taking the directory that we passed it and then replacing that at the end with this data.json for the output. I think the most sensible thing to do here would be to just remove this forward slash and then let's rerun our pipeline. Simple as that. In our pipeline too, we can clone the pipeline run, and really, with all the same configurations, let's give it a go. I believe the clone will pick up on the new pipeline file that we just uploaded, but we'll indeed see if that's the case in just a couple of minutes. And with another failure, let's check the logs. It looks like we're having the same error, so whether it picked up a cached version of that YAML file, or whether the clone is somehow picking up on the old version, let's just go ahead and create a fresh pipeline run in the console here. And third time's the charm, let this run. After the third time is not a charm, we're still seeing that failure. It seems we've debugged a little bit inappropriately here. It's looking for the directory when it does not yet exist. So let's go back to that cloud storage, create that directory, and then we should be in good shape here. It turns out the fourth time's the charm. Let's clone and run that pipeline again. And finally, we have our completed tasks here. This is great as we now have our embeddings completely generated for all those existing blog posts. Let's look at the cloud storage bucket to see the format for this file. In our engine, we have this data file here. Let's download this and look at it. The core of this is going to be a new line delimited JSON file where we have the blog post ID, which is just the file name without the markdown file extension and then the embedding. Again, this is key to the concept here as we're mapping the natural language into a vector of real float values that we can then use for similarity tasks in a variety of machine learning algorithms. We also have the optional restricts field, which can be used for filtering and separating vectors into logical boundaries. In any case, this is great. Now we have what we need to be able to run our Terraform provisioning as we've got our data file in this path here. Now, just to talk about this a little bit more before we provision it, this is going to use a brute force cosine distance between vectors when finding nearest neighbors. What this means is that we're not finding approximate nearest neighbors here, but actually calculating all the distances involved between these vectors. We've chosen this method because we're dealing with a relatively small number of vectors and don't need more advanced approximate nearest neighbor algorithms. We're also doing L2 normalization and cosine distance because we want to compare the distance between these vectors without respect to magnitude. Let's give this provisioning another try now. These indexes can take a while to initially provision. There are ways to update existing indexes, but the initial creation could take a while. Now that our Terraform provisioning is complete, we can actually use our index. If we click into our similarity post index, we'll note that it hasn't been deployed to any endpoints yet. Now, we're going to do this in Python code so that we can pretty easily undeploy the index when we don't need to be running inferences. In our code here, we'll provide some results in placeholders to create an independent way to deploy the endpoint. We do need the project number, which we can get from the homepage. Once we have our endpoint, we will use that ID here. Let's run this first command now. Okay, we have our endpoint. Let's just use that ID it provides us here for our next command. If we need to delete this endpoint later, for cost reasons, we can do that with that command there. Let's deploy our endpoint with that new index that we created. Now, let's go ahead and run that deployment. Keep in mind that this deployment will take some time. We can watch the status here and specify our region, but again, this will be a pretty long operation. And the deployment is now showing as completed, so we have our endpoint to use for inferences. Now keep in mind that with this deployed index, we're going to be paying significantly more than when the index is just sitting around undeployed. So you may want to undeploy or delete these indexes when you're not using them. In any case, let's proceed on to actually running inferences. Let's create a new directory and we'll call it Generate Recommendations. Here's our pipeline code. A little bit more complex than the last pipeline, but still not too bad. We have a couple of tasks here. First, we're going to generate the embeddings for the text that we want to get recommendations for. Then we're going to get recommendations by running an inferencing match on our newly deployed vector similarity engine. We just need to supply the index endpoint here. Let's grab that ID and put it in this string. That's about all we need. We're going to provide a couple of parameters to this pipeline through pipeline arguments here, such as the bucket name. This one's a little bit more parameterized than the last one, which is important since some of the properties may change when we're running inferences. For example, the blog post that we're interested in running an inference on. So let's generate a pipeline file for this workflow. We will show how to run this pipeline through the Cloud Console, but keep in mind that you could also run this pipeline from an IDE using a gcloud command or Python script. Let's call this one recommendations.yaml in our bucket. So, over in Vertex AI, we can now go to pipelines and create a pipeline run. As usual, we'll import from cloud storage and use that new recommendations.yaml pipeline that we just created. Now, a really important configuration here is that we need to supply a VPC network as we don't have a public endpoint for this matching engine index. We're using the GA functionality of a private endpoint rather than the preview for public endpoints. Therefore, we need to provide a string here for our network. The format is going to look like this, and we just need to replace this with the project number, which in our case is this. We've got a good setup there. Go ahead and use that same bucket for the output directory. And then in the pipeline parameters here, we're going to specify the bucket and the blog post that we'd like to run this inferencing on. So let's take a look back at our data. Let's, for example, pick a blog post and find recommended blog posts for it. Let's do Introduction to Cloud Computing for Research, for example. Now let's get to the actual markdown file to show as well. All right, so here's our markdown file. We currently have the recommended posts listed here, but let's use our new system and generate some recommendations for it. This will be in the blog post slash content folder, and we'll take that markdown file name as our blog post file path. That's the path within our bucket. Let's give this a try and see if we can get it right on the first pass. Now we see that the embeddings have been generated for that blog post that we provided, and we can see them here. Next, we're going to run a check for the nearest neighbors within our matching engine system. And with the pipeline totally complete now, we can see the output for the recommended posts. I deliberately set the nearest neighbors to 4 so that we could see the top 3 recommendations. The reason for that difference of 1 is that we actually have this post in our embeddings in the match engine already. So, of course, it's going to find an incredibly small, negligible distance between the post and itself because they're identical. So really, the next 3 posts are the ones that we want to use, and they have a non-negligible distance. For this example, in the Introduction to Cloud Computing for Research, our first recommended post is why and how businesses should run simulations in the cloud. The next best option is sustainability with on-prem and cloud simulation, which again feels pretty close conceptually to our cloud engineering-focused blog post. Lastly, the third recommendation is the spectrum of abstraction with cloud services and simulation software. So we've now created a data-driven and pipeline-optimized way to generate related posts for all of our new posts. Note that if we don't already have a post in our embeddings, we won't get this top option where it's matching with itself. We'll provide all the code that we used today in the description of this video, and we want to thank you for watching.